So this once again a case based interactive session. So first of all, let us have a clear cut idea about what is heart failure. Heart failure is due to contractile abnormality, relaxation abnormality, structural abnormality, functional abnormality, all of the above, which is causing heart failure. Previously, heart failure was thought to be only contractile dysfunction of the heart. Heart is not able to pump. People thought it is due to heart failure. But today, the heart failure is a complex clinical syndrome that can result from any structural or functional cardiac disorder. Not necessarily you need to have a structural abnormality like mitral stenosis or early vegetation to have heart failure. Even functional disorder, just a severe arrhythmia or a severe hypertension, can produce heart failure even in the presence of a structurally normal heart. So structural and functional cardiac disease that impairs the ability of the heart to fill or eject blood. Eject blood is systolic abnormality. To fill is the relaxation or the diastolic abnormality. That's why if you go to this definition and see, the heart failure can be a contractile abnormality or a relaxation abnormality. It can be due to a structural abnormality or it may be due to a functional abnormality. So all the four can cause a heart failure. So nowadays the modern definition of heart failure is this. It's no longer a disease. It is a complex clinical syndrome. Structural or functional cardiac disorder that impairs the ability of the ventricle to fill or eject blood. So this is a patient with a clinical case. So you have a 50 years old gentleman, diabetes and hypertensive, on treatment, recent backache on treatment with NSAIDs, COX-2 inhibitors, is also on metformin and pioglitazone. Class 2 breathlessness for last 1 year. He comes with an orthopnea, breathless less than accustomed exertion, edema for the last 1 month. So this is the presenting illness of a patient who is a diabetic and hypertensive on treatment with some drugs and the presentation. Is it ready? So I'm asking you now, the patient is in, you can answer orally now. The patient is in which class of heart failure? Yes? 3 or 4?
4.
Okay, you can connect it there, it's not coming. Okay, answer now, let's see it's 3 or 4. But 4 is the right answer. Whenever the patient has got orthopnea, orthopnea is dyspnea at what? At rest or an exertion. So when the patient has an orthopnea, that means it's got dyspnea and rest. When the patient has got dyspnea and PND, please remember, when the patient has got dyspnea and PND, he is in class 4 of heart failure. So this is class 4. Sudden death is more common in which heart failure? New heart association 1 and 2 or 3 and 4?
Sudden cardiovascular disease. Death.
See, contrary to belief, class 3 and 4, the death is due to progressive heart failure. Whereas if you see in class 1 and 2, we can see that the sudden death is more common in patients with the new heart association in class 2 and class 3. Whereas in class 4 only, the heart failure is due to progressive deterioration of cardiac function. So although the patient is less symptomatic, doesn't mean he's not having any tendency for a sudden death. So most often, in the early stages of heart failure, the problem is sudden cardiac death. So you can look at the mortality here. This is a pre-AC inhibitor era. Why we want to classify the heart failure into no heart association is when the patient is in class 2 or class 3, in 2 years, you can see that if it's class 1 or 2, 20% mortality. 2 or 3 is 50%, class 4 is 65%. This is of course previous to AC inhibitors introduction and beta blocker introduction. Of course this is significantly reduced to the tune of around 30% now. So the beta blockers, AC inhibitors have reduced the mortality to the tune of 30% now. So it will be around 20 or 25% now. So you have seen the class of heart failure. Now I'm asking you the stage of heart failure. In what stage of heart failure the patient is in? A, B, C, and D. Is stage C. So you have to differentiate between what is functional class versus the staging of heart failure. The functional classification is new heart association 1 to 4. As you know, it's from the more than accustomed accession to dyspnea at rest. Whereas stage of heart failure is 4 stages. 4 stages are stage A is patient is having conditions which will predispose to heart failure. At this point, patient does not have heart failure, but has conditions like diabetes, hypertension, family history of dilated cardiomyopathy. So he's got some condition which will predispose him to heart failure is stage A. Stage B is asymptomatic heart disease, where the patient has got asymptomatic liver dysfunction or a valvular disease, but patient does not have symptoms. He's got some disease, but symptom is not there, is stage B. Stage C is patient having prior or present heart failure. He has suffered from heart failure in the previous months or years, or now he has got heart failure, is stage C. Stage C is symptoms of heart failure present or past. Stage D heart failure is refractory heart failure. In spite of your treatment, the patient continued to have symptoms and signs of heart failure, is stage D. So, new heart association helps you to assess the prognosis to see whether your treatment is working or not, whether the patient is progressing or not. Whereas the purpose of staging the heart failure into A, B, C, and D is for prevention of heart failure. For example, let us say you see a patient at stage A, your job is to prevent stage B, to prevent an asymptomatic heart disease. If you are seeing in stage B, your job is to prevent stage C. If you are seeing in stage C, revert him to stage B, doesn't allow him to go for stage D. When you are seeing him in stage D, avoid another D. What is another D? Death. So this is the purpose of staging the classification, A, B, C and D. So this is the purpose. So you have to see, whenever you see a patient with heart failure, functional classification, staging of heart failure. So this will give you what is his basic severity of heart disease, and also what is your purpose of treatment in that patient heart failure. Okay. All of the following are precipitating cause of heart failure, is that precipitating causes. Anemia, beriberi, metformin, NSAIDs, glutathione, infant endocarditis. Good. All the other three are precipitating causes. Metformin does not precipitate heart failure. Nowadays it is safer in patients with heart failure. So all the other things can produce heart failure. This patient is in what heart failure? Stage left-sided failure, right-sided failure, both or neither. This patient had orthopnea. Remember, the patient had orthopnea, class 3 dyspnea. I am asking you, this patient had orthopnea, so I am asking you what failure is. Why both? Yes, patient had edema and also patient had orthopnea. So probably he is, so you must understand, once you stage, once you classify according to your, then you decide whether it is right heart failure, left heart failure or combined heart failure. Right heart failure will produce systemic venous congestion in the form of JVP rise, enlarged liver, ascites, edema, or the signs of systemic venous congestion. Whereas patients with left heart failure will have pulmonary venous congestion manifested by orthopnea, PND and breathlessness. So patient will have both systemic venous congestion and also pulmonary venous congestion, have bi-heart or bi-ventricular failure. So he is supposed to have both failures. Now clinical examination, patient is dyspneic, there is some facial puffiness, JVP is elevated, respiratory rate is increased, pulse rate is increased, he has got a very high blood pressure. 220 bar 120, SAOT is 90%, he's got a left ventricular third heart sound, crepitations are there, right hypochondrial tenderness is there. So there are clinical signs of both left heart failure in the form of third heart sound and the systemic venous congestion in the form of puffiness, right hypochondrial tenderness and so on. Which is the best sign of LV systolic dysfunction? Elevated JVP, mitral regurgitation murmur, third heart sound, fourth heart sound. LV systolic dysfunction. Very good clinical auscultative sign of the heart failure is third heart sound. What is the sign of diastolic dysfunction? What is the clinical sign of diastolic dysfunction? Yes, fourth heart sound. See, you can clinically detect whether the patient has got left ventricular hypertrophy when he has got a fourth heart sound. You need not do even echo. You know the patient has got a diastolic dysfunction because the atrium is contracting powerfully, which is producing the fourth heart sound. When the patient has got third heart sound, it indicates a systolic dysfunction. So very good clinical finding for systolic dysfunction is the third heart sound. Edema usually precedes orthopnea. In heart failure, what do you think? The edema usually precedes orthopnea. True, false? Which comes in heart failure, which comes first? Edema comes first or dyspnea comes first? False. Why? Why? See, usually the events start with the LV dysfunction or a left heart disease like a mitral valve disease. So as I told you last class, we have seen about pulmonary hypertension. Any left heart disease by the transmission of left atrial pressure to the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure and so on will ultimately get transferred to the pulmonary artery. So the patient develop what type of pulmonary hypertension now with the left heart disease? Post-capillary. So he will develop a post-capillary pulmonary hypertension. Because of pulmonary hypertension, then the right heart will fail. So understand. So to start with, the patient will have left heart symptoms. Then ultimately, in a long-standing pulmonary hypertension, will ultimately produce a right heart failure. Then the patient develops edema or LRJVP or ascites and so on. And people also say that once the patient develops a right heart failure, the left heart failure symptoms usually will disappear. Patient so far had a PND and orthopnea. Once he develops a right heart failure, the PND and orthopnea will go off. Why? Because the amount of blood coming into the left heart itself is reduced because of the right heart failure. Because of the decreased preload to the left heart symptoms likely to come down. So you should not think that you are treating well and patient has got relieved of orthopnea and PND. He is worsening. Because he is having a right heart failure, his left-sided symptoms are coming less. So this is the events which will happen right from the start of heart failure. Age dyspnea, orthopnea, PND, pulmonary hypertension, right heart failure and so on. So usually the edema comes after the orthopnea. In right heart failure, ascites precedes edema. If you have a particular condition, for example, in this but any patient with a heart failure, ascites comes first and edema comes later. What do you think? It's a pericardial disease, heart failure, both are renal disease. Yes, it's usually pericardial disease. What is it called? Ascites. Ascites precox. Usually in right heart failure, edema starts in the legs and ascends, whereas in pericardial disease, ascites comes first, then edema. So it's a very important clinical information. If you are able to get, it gives you valuable clues regarding diagnosis. Edema ascends, that means edema starts in the legs and goes up, is heart failure. Edema descends, starts in the face and comes down. It is most often renal. Edema starts in the middle, in the abdomen, is most often pericardial disease. So, you know where the edema starts will give you a valuable clue regarding the pericardial disease, renal disease and heart failure. So, usually the cardiac edema is the dependent edema. So, for example, patient is long-standing bedridden, bedridden. There is no point in seeing edema in the legs. You must always see it in the pre-sacral area. The pitting and ascites preceding edema, I told you about the pericardial disease. Facial puffiness is usually late in heart failure. It may occur in the adults due to renal disease. JVP elevated with pulsation. JVP elevated with pulsation. Heart failure, pericardial disease, increased heart rate pressure, all of the above. The right answer is all of the above. Whenever the JVP is elevated with the pulsation, it can be any of these three situations, heart failure, pericardial disease, increased heart rate pressure. If the JVP is elevated without pulsation, what is it? It is SVC obstruction. So I give you some clues about JVP, clinical examination, JVP. So you know the JVP is the most difficult thing. We have so many waves, A, C, V, Y, X and all that. We are all confused with what is A, what is A and so on. So in simple terms, what we must see is, we must see there are positive waves and negative waves. So the JMB wave coming out is positive wave, going down is negative wave. Positive waves are two things, atrial contraction as well as atrial filling. Right atrial contraction and right atrial filling will produce two positive waves, which are called A and B waves. The two negative waves can be due to atrial relaxation or atrial empty. The two waves, negative waves, are because of decrease in RA pressure. Decrease in RA pressure can happen when the atrium relaxes or when the atrium is emptying into the right ventricle. So two negative waves are due to relaxation and emptying. Relaxation is X descent, emptying is Y descent. So that's all the JVP. So if you see that A wave is due to atrial contraction and X descent is due to atrial relaxation, V wave is due to atrial filling, Y descent is due to atrial emptying. That's all. Four waves, two positive waves, two negative waves. So if you look at here, so I want you to see only when there is a positive waves or negative waves. Whenever the JVP is elevated with a very prominent positive waves, especially the V wave, elevated but the positive waves are prominent, you know that the JVP elevation is due to heart failure. Whereas JVP is elevated, but you don't see the positive wave, only the negative waves are prominent. You see the negative waves are prominent, it is pericardial disease. No JVP at all, even in lying position, patient is coming with you shock. Even lying position, you are not able to see JVP. Most often the shock is due to hypovolemia. In cardiac disease, you must rule out excessive diuretic therapy. Whereas in the patient coming to you with a shock, but JVP is standing. Even in lying, even sitting position, the JVP is so prominent, but the patient has got no blood pressure. Most often it is due to heart failure and pericardial disease. Whenever there is an edema, always look at the JVP. If you have an edema without a JVP increase, most often the edema is not cardiac. Because any cardiac edema should increase RA pressure. It should have been transmitted to the superior vena cava and inferior vena cava. The transmission in inferior vena cava produces the edema. Same time, the transmission to the superior vena cava is supposed to produce the JVP. So if you have a JVP, no JVP at all with an edema, most often it may be non-cardiac causes. So these are the valuable clues from the JVP available to you to diagnose various sets of diseases. All of the following are signs of left ventricular dysfunction except sinus tachycardia, good heart sounds, third heart sound, hepatojugular reflex. Yes, both answers can be taken as right, but I prefer this important, you know, LV dysfunction can would have got right heart failure and produce this. But whenever you have a left ventricular dysfunction, the heart sounds are muffled. One of the important signs of LV dysfunction is muffling of heart sounds. So hepatojugular reflex also taken as right answer, but this I want this as the right answer first, because whenever you have LV dysfunction, you have muffled heart sound. So if you see the clinical signs of LV dysfunction, first is sinus tachycardia, second is muffled heart sounds, third heart sound, the dyskinetic apex over the parasternal area, third heart sound, systolic dysfunction, fourth heart sound, diastolic dysfunction. So hepatojugular reflex is early evidence of right heart failure, probably due to left ventricular dysfunction. So these are the signs of left ventricular dysfunction, clinical signs of left ventricular dysfunction. So whenever you have sinus tachycardia with a very good intensity of heart sounds, most often systolic heart failure may not be there. This patient likely to have bad prognosis. He's got diabetes, hypertension, blood pressure is 220, third heart sound, edema is there. So true, false, certain. Next. Believe this patient as a bad prognosis. The thing is false. See, what determines the prognosis is admission systolic pressure. Contrary to belief, higher the admission systolic pressure, better the prognosis. So in acute pulmonary, if the patient has got a very high blood pressure, he will come out. In acute pulmonary, if a patient has got hardly 100 blood pressure or less than 100 systolic blood pressure, he may not come out at all. So this is a very important clinical sign to assess the prognosis as the patient is getting admitted to pulmonary edema. So good systolic pressure on admission indicator, you can see in-hospital mortality is determined by the systolic pressure on admission. Higher the systolic pressure, better the prognosis. What systolic pressure this patient has? 220. So he is likely to have come out of this problem. So this presentation, I primarily, it's a short presentation, primarily given you some idea about the clinical examination in heart failure. So that's what to be seen, how to differentiate and so on. So my next presentation is primarily revolving around the treatment or the management of heart failure. So I'm going to concentrate on the heart failure management, especially chronic heart failure management in this presentation. So although we are treating heart failure for so many years now, many years now, there are still so much of dilemmas and also difficulties in treatment exist. So what I am going to do is address those dilemmas and difficulties in the treatment of heart failure. So there are good news and bad news about heart failure. The good news is we have decrease in mortality in heart failure. Heart failure patients are living longer. This is because we have significant advances in therapy, best drugs available now, and most of us practice what is known as an evidence-based medicine. We give appropriate drugs, we give drugs which will increase the lifespan and the patients are living longer. The bad news is increase in heart failure incidence. Although mortality is coming down, incidence of heart failure is increasing. Ironically, it is because of advances in therapy. Because of advances in therapy, patients are living longer. Because they are living longer, they have heart failure. And of course, once again, increase in elderly population. Once again, we are making patients living longer with the good drugs. So, elderly patients are likely to have heart failure. So, once again, as I told you yesterday, the price we pay for making patients living longer is heart failure and atrial fibrillation. So, it's not without a problem. So, we are happy the patients are living longer, but they have heart failure and so on. That's why I used to say, the patients were dying previously. Patients with the massive myocardial infarctions were dying previously. Now you do a stent and make him live. This will all answer the heart failure later. Then you put a cardiac resonance therapy to him. Right? So this is where, because these people were, because there was no advances in therapy in acute infarction, coronary syndrome, people are dying and going. But these patients are living now. Ultimately, they'll end up with a heart failure. So you must know that when you treat a heart failure, what are the goals of therapy in heart failure? So goals of therapy in heart failure is to relieve the symptom of heart failure and give a good quality of life. That is an important goal, first goal. We have to make the patient happy. So these two things make the patient happy because he's got no edema now, he's got no dyspnea now, he's happy. But we must also do halt the progression of the disease, progression of heart failure, and reduce the mortality in heart failure. Here, doctor is happy. So the goals of therapy in heart failure to make both doctor and patient happy. So patient should be happy without symptoms. Doctor is happy because he is halting the progression of disease. He is making the patient to live longer so that he comes for recurrent admission. So this is how we must do in patients. Patient happy, doctor is happy. Then what are the types of therapy available to us in heart failure? So as you can see, this is the mortality. New York Heart Association, I told you, this is before AC inhibitor era. We have a significant mortality increase there. So this is, I told you, about the staging of heart failure. So this is a staging, as I told you. Stage 1, patient has got a heart disease, but with heart disease which will predispose him to heart failure, stage A. Stage B, asymptomatic heart disease. The mortality is 5 to 10%, 2 to 3% here. Stage C, symptomatic heart failure, past or present, 15 to 30% mortality. Whereas stage D, refractory heart failure, more than 50% mortality. So this is the staging of heart failure and heart functional classification I told you. So in any heart failure, you must put the functional class and staging of heart failure so that you know what to be done there. There are different types of therapy available to us now. First and most important drugs are mortality reducing drugs. Drugs will make the patient live longer are angiotensin converting inhibitors, beta blocker, aldosterone antagonist, sometimes receptor blockers, and combination of nitrate and hydralazine. So these are the five groups of drugs which can increase the longevity of the patient. Then we have drugs which will give the symptomatic benefit to the patient. These drugs are which will relieve edema, which will relieve the dyspnea, are diuretics, loop diuretics, and digoxin. So these are the drugs which will give symptomatic benefit. And we have certain drugs which will not act on the heart rate or blood pressure or the hemodynamic status of the patient. They will give important advantage to the metabolism of the heart muscle cell, metabolically acting drugs. They will change the metabolism of the cell, make the cell live longer. They are trimetazidine, carnitine, coenzyme Q. Now we have newer and emerging drugs in evobrutinib and omega-3 fatty acids in the treatment of heart failure. So these are the drugs which are available to us in the first group. In the second group, we have drugs which are supportive. Although they do not directly do anything for heart failure, it is a treatment of iron, a treatment of anemia, oral anticoagulants in the presence of a thrombus, electrolyte correcting drugs, and also drugs for the comorbid conditions. So these are the drugs which are supportive drugs. And the third group of drugs we must definitely know, and these are harmful drugs. So these are the drugs which should not be given to cardiac failure patient. Daily, routinely every 15 days, inotropic support, antiarrhythmic drugs like the except beta blockers and amiodarone like propofenon, fluconide, yesterday I told you, disopyramide, all other antiarrhythmic drugs except beta blockers and amiodarone, non-dihydropyridine calcium blockers like verapamil and diltiazem, and very high dose of digoxin itself is bad. So these are some of the cardiac drugs we should not expose to the patient. Routine inotropes, antiarrhythmic drugs, calcium blockers, and high dose digoxin. So we have three types of drugs. One is the one first group, mortality reducing, morbidity reducing, metabolically acting, and newer drugs. And the secondly, you have the supportive drugs. And thirdly, you have the drugs we should not use it in heart failure. So these are the types of therapy we available. Then we have how to use this drug properly. What are the dilemmas available? What are the dilemmas that are there in the treatment of heart failure today? It is very important to understand that the heart failure treatment starts with general measures. The first important general measure is daily weighing of the patient. Correctable causes. First, correctable causes. For example, patient has got a structural heart disease which is precipitating heart failure. You have to, structural heart disease has to be corrected. Valvular heart disease has to be corrected. Shunt should be closed. Coronary heart disease has to be addressed. So you correct the correctable cause. And of course, it's a good practice to make the patient to weigh daily so that any increase in weight more than 2 kgs in 1 to 2 3 days, he must be able to report to you, because the earliest evidence of fluid retention is increase in weight. So the daily weighing will identify earliest fluid retention in the body. So the patient is able to reduce salt, fluid, and adjust the diuretics. We can prevent overt heart failure at this point in time. And some educated patients can be advised to manage the diuretic themselves by when they say increase in weight, or they see some edema, they see that the dyspnea is increasing, they can increase the diuretics. The most important thing is to advise the patient and motivate the patient to take medicines properly, regularly, and continuously. When the patient becomes asymptomatic, he can do regular exercise, which will be beneficial to diabetes, hypertension, and cholesterol. Patients should totally stop smoking and alcohol. Salt and fluid management, especially as I told you in the morning, the salt restriction, severe salt restriction in the summer may be a problem. But most often the salt is usually restricted to 2 to 3 grams per day. And the fluid is restricted to 1500 ml per day. All fluid included. That not only water, all fluid less than 1500 ml per day. And of course, Nowadays, we give vaccination, pneumococcal vaccination, and viral fever, flu vaccination for patients, especially in the winter, because we know the main precipitating cause of heart failure is infection, especially respiratory infection. Avoiding respiratory infection is it will prevent a heart failure. Of course, you must warn the patient about the drugs which will precipitate heart failure, like routine use of NSAIDs, continuous use of vitamin E, and alternate system medicines can precipitate a heart failure. And as I told you, in any heart failure, always look at precipitating cause of heart failure. Patient may have a basic disease, but what precipitates heart failure is the one which is the problem. So here, you must not only treat heart failure, but also simultaneously you must treat precipitating cause of heart failure. So you can look at the precipitating cause of heart failure here, from A, B, C, D, and E, and so on. So whenever the patient comes with a heart failure, go through this list. So you know which is precipitating heart failure, you must simultaneously treat that. Then only your success will be there. A for anemia, arrhythmias like atrial fibrillation and alcohol. B is for beriberi. C for cardiac toxin, as I told you, some drugs and alternative medicines and so on. Drugs like NSAIDs, glitazones and steroids. Always go through the drug list whenever the patient has got heart failure. Severe exercise, emotion and pulmonary embolism can precipitate heart failure. Fever, important cause of heart failure. Goiter, thyroid, hypothyroidism, hyperthyroidism, both can produce heart failure. Severe hypertension and hypoxia can precipitate a heart failure. So infections can produce heart failure. Iatrogenic, excessive IV fluids can also precipitate a heart failure. So any heart failure, go through the list of precipitating cause of heart failure. You must simultaneously address the precipitating cause of heart failure in addition to treatment of heart failure per se. So this is a very busy slide, but this slide gives you everything about heart failure. The single slide will give you everything about heart failure. So the heart failure is nothing but the left ventricle or the right ventricle is not contracting properly, not relaxing properly. So that's why the heart failure is there. So because the heart is not contracting and relaxing properly, there is a significant increase in the ventricular pressure. The increase in ventricular pressure is transmitted backwards to the right atrium as well as the left atrium. If the left atrial pressure is transmitted to the pulmonary capillary wedge, the patient will have pulmonary venous congestion and evidence of left heart disease, arthropneia, PND and arthropneia. So arthropneia, PND and the dyspnea is evidence of pulmonary venous congestion. This congestion is happening because the backward transmission of pressure from the left atrial, left atrium and to the wedge. So this is called backward failure, left-sided backward failure. Whereas significant increase in the right-sided, right ventricle, transmit pressures to the right atrium. The right atrium transmits pressure to the systemic veins. So on the right side, backward pressure is systemic venous congestion. So the congestion is evidence of backward failure because the pressure is getting transmitted backwards and producing the problem. Whereas when the ventricle is not able to pump outside enough stroke volume outside, enough cardiac output outside, the patient is having evidence of low cardiac output, low blood volume, which is called forward failure. The forward failure is because the inability of the heart to produce adequate cardiac output forward. So that's why it's called forward failure. Backward failure is congestion. Forward failure is reduced perfusion. So when you have evidence of reduced perfusion, like low blood pressure, tachycardia, cold and clammy extremities, that means the patient is not putting adequate output outside. So this is the concept of forward failure and backward failure. Most often when the patient comes with acute heart failure, it can be a backward failure or it can be a forward failure or both. If the patient comes with very good blood pressure, here the patient is in the last presentation we saw a patient who's got a very good blood pressure, but he had evidence of congestion, isn't it? He had an arthropneia, he had an edema, he had a JVP. So he is in backward failure. Whereas some patients may come to you with a clear lungs. Absolutely clear lungs, no edema, no congestion in the lungs, but BP is very low. He is tachycardic. He is in what? Forward failure. Some people who come with both, low blood pressure, at the same time congestion. These people are in the combination of forward and backward failure. So, in acute heart failure, you decide whether it's a backward failure, forward failure, or combination of both. Then accordingly you treat the patient. Whereas in chronic heart failure, what happens is, I told you, because of the low cardiac output, low stroke volume, there are many compensatory mechanisms are put in place to compensate for the low blood pressure and the low blood volume. So the body detects the blood pressure is low, blood volume inside the vessel is low. So what it does, it tries to increase blood pressure, it tries to restore the blood volume by stimulating certain mechanisms. That mechanisms are renin-angiotensin mechanism, aldosterone mechanism, and sympathetic stimulation, and adrenergic stimulation and sympathetic system mechanism. So these are the three important mechanisms which are put in place by the body to restore the blood pressure and blood volume. The irony in heart failure is the overshooting of these compensatory mechanisms further worsen heart failure. The mechanisms are put in place to restore the blood pressure and blood volume. What these compensatory mechanisms do? They will excessively increase blood pressure, they excessively restore the blood volume. So that means you are failing heart when it's excessively increasing the blood pressure. Your failing heart has to pump against increased resistance. Your failing heart has to pump in more blood because it receives more volume. So that is a problem of heart failure. That's why success in heart failure came. The mortality in heart failure got reduced. Only we understood this mechanism and started blocking this overshooting of compensatory mechanisms like renin-angiotensin system, aldosterone system, and the sympathetic system. So this is the principle in treatment of chronic heart failure. Blocking the excessively acting compensatory mechanisms. So this is what the acute heart failure is. An acute heart failure patient, as I told you, can come with a congestion or a low perfusion. If he is coming with a congestion, he will be warm because his perfusion is all right, but he will be wet because he's got a lung congestion, he's got edema. So the warm and wet tells you the patient has got predominant what failure? Congestion is a backward failure. So here you treat him with the diuretics and vasodilators to relieve the congestion, to reduce the peripheral resistance and increase the cardiac output. So whenever the patient comes with the congestion at rest, perfusion is all right, the treatment is diuretic, vasodilator. There is an ultrafiltration, it's mechanical means of removing the water. So these are the treatment modalities when the patient is warm and wet. He is warm, that means his perfusion is all right, but he is wet because of congestion. Whereas look at this situation, his perfusion is not all right, he is cold. That means his tachycardia, 30 pulse, low blood pressure, but his lungs are clear, he has got no edema. That means he does not have a congestion. What failure he has got now? Forward failure. So here you make the heart to pump powerfully to increase the cardiac output. You give what? Positive inotropic agents here. When the patient comes with a forward failure, the treatment is to give a positive inotropic agent to increase the contraction to put in the more output. Whereas this situation, cold and wet, what does it mean? He is in forward failure, he is in backward failure. So here you have to use the combination of diuretics plus positive inotropic agents, the prognosis is bad. Ultimately, your aim is to bring the patient at this square. What is this square? There is no congestion at rest, no perfusion at rest. What is that? It is warm and dry. So this is a square you must bring the patient to, this square of warm and dry. Warm means perfusion is all right, dry means his congestion is not there. So this is the principle of treatment in acute heart failure. Warm and wet, cold and dry, cold and wet. Ultimately, bring the patient to warm and dry situation of good perfusion and no congestion. So this is how you treat acute heart failure. Right? Through three important drugs only in acute heart failure. Diuretics, vasodilators, positive inotropic agent. Or the combination. Right? So this is how we treated the backward failure with the diuretics. We treated the forward failure with the positive inotropic agents. The combination, when the combination of problems are there. Now I have to treat a chronic heart failure. So first thing, I have to block this renin-angiotensin system. So I have to block this renin-angiotensin system with how, I must know how the angiotensin 2 is produced. The angiotensin 2, which is produced from angiotensinogen, converted into angiotensin II either through converting enzyme pathway or many of non-converting enzyme pathways. So there are many pathways which can convert the angiotensin 1 to 2. Once the angiotensin 2 is formed through the converting enzyme, the angiotensin 2 acting on the AT1 receptor produces all the problems. It produces vessel constriction, it produces the smooth muscle hypertrophy, retains sodium and water, produces sympathetic activation. Angiotensin 2 also produces increase in aldosterone, which further retains sodium and water. Not only that, the converting enzyme also breaks down a very important molecule, very good molecule of bradykinin into inactive fragments. So all these problems are happening because of the angiotensin 2, which is exaggerating the heart failure, which is producing progression of heart failure. So how will we block this system? We can block renin through direct renin inhibitors, but as I told you in the morning, no longer we use them for cardiac disease. Then the good old angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors, we block the converting enzyme so that we prevent the formation of angiotensin 2 from angiotensin 1. Then we block the receptor by using receptor blockers. Then we give the aldosterone antagonist to block the aldosterone. This is how we are blocking the renin angiotensin system at various levels. Especially in heart failure, we will be using three important drugs in this situation: converting enzyme inhibitors, receptor blockers, and aldosterone inhibitors, so that we will prevent the angiotensin formation, we prevent the angiotensin's action on the receptor, we also block the aldosterone. So this is how the treatment of renin inhibition happens. So although we have been using the ACE inhibitor for many, many years, there are so many dilemmas when we use. Because we have two drugs, ACE inhibitors and receptor blockers, the dilemma comes which to use, which is better. Second, having decided to use which ACE inhibitor we must use, which receptor blocker we must use, then whether we can combine both ACE inhibitors and ARBs in the treatment of heart failure. When the patient has got a renal failure, how to use this drug? Because these drugs may be double-edged weapons in the presence of a renal failure. So these are the dilemmas exist when we use ACE inhibitors in heart failure. So when we compare the ACE inhibitors and ARBs in heart failure, ACE inhibitors have got many trials. They have significant mortality reduction. In addition to heart failure mortality reduction, they decrease myocardial infarctions. Whereas receptor blockers do not decrease myocardial infarctions. We have few trials, less benefit. Even in asymptomatic left atrial dysfunction, stage B of heart failure, you can use ACE inhibitor. There is no evidence for receptor blockers here. They are cost effective. For example, even if you use the costless band of ramipril of 10 mg, it will cost you 14 rupees per day. If you use valsartan, it will cost you 24 rupees per day. So you are using costly drug for a less benefit. So that's why in heart failure, ACE inhibitors are the first drug of choice. Only when the ACE inhibitors are not tolerated because of the severe cough, you have to switch on to receptor blockers. When you switch on to receptor blockers, the receptor blockers which will work in heart failure is valsartan. So if at all you are using a receptor blocker in heart failure and LV dysfunction, it should be valsartan. Whereas in ACE inhibitors, all ACE inhibitors are good for heart failure. So you can use any ACE inhibitor in heart failure, but the first choice is ACE inhibitor. So, only situation we combine ACE inhibitor and ARBs is in very severe chronic heart failure. Only in this situation, in spite of using ACE inhibitor full dose or ARBs full dose, still the patient has got significant hypertension, heart failure, then you can combine, but carefully you have to watch for creatinine and potassium and also hypotension. So, you should not combine all the three, ACE inhibitors, ARB and aldosterone inhibitors, because they will produce significant hyperkalemia. So that's why in only one situation you can combine ACE inhibitor ARB is severe refractory chronic heart failure. So the kidney, as far as the kidney is concerned, you can give ACE inhibitors or ARB up to creatinine 2.5, but with lot of caution. It's preferable not to use this drug when the creatinine is more than 2.5. So always repeat creatinine and potassium within a week. As I told you, when the creatinine doubles from the baseline, crosses 2.5 or increases more than 30% from the baseline, you have to stop. When the potassium crosses 5.5, you have to stop. do not combine with the other RAS inhibitor. Do not use only one RAS inhibitor, either ARBs or ACI or aldosterone inhibitor. Do not combine any other RAS blocker with this present drug. So these are the precautions we must take when you use the ACE inhibitors or ARBs in the presence of a renal failure. So these are the initial drug of choice in any stage, any class of heart failure. Let it be class 1, let it be class A. These are the best drugs. In all classes, in all stages, ACE inhibitors are the best. They are mortality reducing drugs. I told you the first group of drugs. Check creatinine and potassium before and after starting. Don't start ACE inhibitors, especially when the patient is dehydrated, when he has got supposed to have a low sodium. What is important is the uptitration. Do not start with a small dose and be happy about it. When the patient's blood pressure is okay, he is tolerating, you have to go to the maximum tolerated dose of ACE inhibitors in ARB. Then only you will get the benefit of RAS blockade. Patient is motivated to accept cough ACE inhibitors. We always have the habit of stopping ACE inhibitor when the patient's neighbor coughs. Patient need not cough. When the patient neighbor coughs, you stop ACE inhibitor, especially ACE inhibitor is started by other doctor, which I don't like. Right? So we'll say we become the hero in the patient, because stopping ACE inhibitor, cough immediately will go. You'll become a hero in patient's eyes, but you are not doing justice to the patient. So many times what we must do is don't immediately stop, routinely stop ACE inhibitor because of mild cough. You ask the patient to accept the cough and continue ACE inhibitor. Many of the patients will continue ACE inhibitor accepting the cough because ACE inhibitors only will give the maximum benefit in heart failure. Receptor blockers may not give the same benefit as ACE inhibitor in heart failure. So I used to say it is better to cough than die. So like that. So contraindications are pregnancy or people likely to become pregnancy. Not only people are pregnant. When the person is likely to become pregnant, you don't use ACE inhibitor. And obstructive lesions like aortic stenosis and mitral stenosis, bilateral renal artery stenosis, severe renal failure, hyperkalemia, you are not supposed to use the ACE inhibitors or ARBs. So now we have blocked renin-angiotensin system. What is the next system available to us? We have to block the sympathetic system. Many times the patient becomes better, he becomes asymptomatic, he is walking, he would have come and seen you the previous day. You have said you are very good, I am walking 1 kilometer, sir, he is happy, you are happy. Next day morning you will see his photo in the paper, in the obituary column. In the morning walking he died. Right? He would have gone previous day, he would have happy, he is walking 1 kilometer, he will say, you are very happy that he is doing well. Next day he would have died suddenly. So that is a problem of heart failure. Sudden death we cannot predict in heart failure. As I told you, even it is more common in patients who are less symptomatic, like class 1 or 2. Right? That's why if you want to, so ACE inhibitors may prevent the progression of heart failure, but it will not prevent sudden death. Sudden death is primarily because of arrhythmia. Why this arrhythmia is coming? Because of increased sympathetic system will produce dangerous arrhythmias and produce death. So the next system we are going to block is adrenergic system. As you know, the adrenergic system, the sympathetic system acting on the beta 1 receptor, producing significant myocardial necrosis, acting on the beta 2 receptor, producing significant arrhythmias and sudden death, acting on the alpha 1 receptor, producing significant vasoconstriction and myocyte hypertrophy. So if at all you want to block the sympathetic system, you can block the beta 1 receptor selectively by means of bisoprolol, long acting metoprolol or nebivolol, or you can block less selectively or non selectively through propranolol and atenolol. You can block both alpha and beta receptors through the carbidolol. So this is how you block the sympathetic system. In heart failure, less selective beta blockers or non-selective beta blockers are contraindicated. So either you have to use a purely selective beta blocker acting on the beta 1 receptor or beta and alpha receptor blocker, not propranolol and atenolol. So having decided to use beta blocker, we've been using beta blockers for so many years now, the dilemma is when and how to start. When should I start? I told you ACE inhibitor can be started at any time, but beta blockers cannot be started like that. Whether to start beta blocker first or ACE inhibitor first? So the practical issues in beta blocker, once again, these are the second group of drugs which will decrease mortality. So in all heart failure patients, they should be on beta blocker like bisoprolol, carvedilol or long-acting metoprolol, sometimes nebivolol. To be started, only when the patient is stabilized with no fluid overload or acute pulmonary edema. Do not start beta blocker in ICU. When the patient comes to acute pulmonary edema, the treatment of choice is congestion, perfusion, correction, then start AC inhibitor, BP is okay, creatinine is okay, potassium is okay. Get him out of ICU when he's asymptomatic, he's got no fluid overload, dyspnea is better, is little stabilized, then only you must start the patient on beta blocker. Because initially when you start beta blocker, there may be an exacerbation of heart failure. There may be increase in heart failure problem when you start beta blocker first. So that's why you have to stabilize the patient and start beta blocker. Start on low dose and increase every 2 weeks. What is the aim in starting beta blocker? Heart rate should be decreased to at least 10 beats per minute. Ideal rate is around 50 to 60 beats per minute at rest. Nebivolol, when the patient has got mild asthma or a peripheral artery disease, still you can use nebivolol. Contraindication to use beta blocker, first degree heart block, bradycardia, when the BNP is more than 1000 microgram, the patient has got a severe COPD, you may not be able to use beta blocker. So this is, start a beta blocker, beware of initial worsening of heart failure. So that's why you have to be very careful. The patient is euvolemic and asymptomatic. Whereas, when the patient is coming to you with a class 4 severe heart failure, severe LV dysfunction and so on, severe heart failure, you must start AC inhibitor immediately, provided the blood pressure is normal. You can start even in ICU immediately, provided the blood pressure is normal. Diabetes, dyskinetic LV, bronchospastic disease, bradycardia and AV block, systemic hypertension in inferior wall MI, because inferior wall MI you have a bradycardia, so it is better to start AC inhibitor, relatively preserved renal function. And whenever you start an AC inhibitor, beware of initial renal worsening. So beta blocker is cardiac worsening, whereas AC inhibitor renal worsening. So you have to watch for the potassium and creatinine when you start an AC inhibitor. So we have blocked renin angiotensin system, we have blocked the adrenergic system. Next system to be blocked is the aldosterone system. The aldosterone system is blocked by two drugs, non-selectively by spironolactone and selectively by eplerenone. So there are two aldosterone antagonists. Once again, these are the third group of drugs which will give you the mortality benefit. AC inhibitor, sometimes ARB, beta blockers and the aldosterone antagonist. Please start only when the creatinine is less than 2.5, potassium is less than 5. Use always either with AC inhibitor or ARB, not with both. You should not give all the three blockers, AC inhibitor, ARBs and aldosterone antagonists will produce severe hyperkalemia. Please remember that the effect is not seen immediately here, not like loop diuretics. Immediately you will get the benefit. The benefit will be seen only after 3 days when you give aldosterone inhibitor. Spironolactone problem is a painful gynecomastia. So that's why the ideal candidate will be, ideal drug will be eplerenone. So ideal candidate will be patient is having some amount of low potassium in spite of using AC inhibitor. This is the welcome addition. So specific drugs to be tried in sleep apnea. I told you the best drug to be tried in sleep apnea, hypertension and heart failure is aldosterone inhibitor. So there are significant advantages of the eplerenone over spironolactone. It is short acting. You can see there is no significant drug interactions. And of course, even in mild heart failure like class 2, you can use eplerenone, whereas spironolactone is only for symptomatic heart failure of class 3 and class 4. So naturally, the third drugs, you have used a renin angiotensin inhibitor, AC inhibitor. Second is you have used beta blocker. Naturally, the third choice comes, people decide whether it's ARB you have to add or an aldosterone inhibitor we have to add. It's better to add aldosterone inhibitor rather than ARB as the third group of drugs in the treatment of heart failure. So we have blocked renin angiotensin system, aldosterone system, and the sympathetic system. Now I have to improve the contractility of my ventricle. Isn't it? I have blocked this compensatory system. I have to improve the contractility of the ventricle by digoxin. So nowadays the digoxin dose, as I told you yesterday, because we know therapeutic level is much less than what we thought previously. So that the dose to be started is first day 1 tablet and subsequently half tablet. Lower doses in patients with renal failure and elderly. Always remember, it takes 5 to 7 days for the steady state to happen. So in symptomatic patients with a reduced heart failure with atrial fibrillation, you can start, but we do not know its benefit in patients with preserved ejection fraction. You must be careful in patients with the thyroid disorders and cord pulmonary. So this is how you improve the cardiac contractile function by digoxin, whereas in acute heart failure with an intravenous positive inotropic agent. Then I must reduce my amount of blood or volume coming into my heart. So I have to reduce my preload. Now I have blocked the sympathetic system, blocked the renin angiotensin system, ultrasound system. I have improved my cardiac contraction. Now I have to reduce the preload or the venous return coming into the heart by using a diuretic. Diuretics can be used in the form of what is known as a sequential nephron blockade. You have to use three different types of diuretic acting on three different sites. When you use furosemide, it acts on the ascending loop of Henle. When you use the drugs like aldosterone inhibitors, they are acting on the distal loop, distal tubule. And when you use thiazide diuretic, they act little distal loop of Henle. So when you combine these three drugs, you will have three diuretics acting in three different portions of nephron. This is called sequential nephron blockade. So the importance, whenever the patient is inside your hospital as an inpatient, when you give a diuretics, make sure you adjust the diuretic dose so that the patient loses 1 kg per day. That is the ideal dose. Because you are giving a diuretic, patient is not losing any weight. That means your diuretic dose is not enough. At least the patient should lose 1 kg per day. That will be the ideal diuretic dose in patients taking treatment as inpatient. So now we have a drug which is called tarsimide. It is better than furosemide because of two reasons. One, it is a long-acting drug. And secondly, it is little friendly to the kidneys. The furosemide is little, it is getting excreted through the kidney, whereas tarsimide is not getting excreted through the kidney. So it is friendly with the renal disease and it is a long-acting. So it's a better drug than furosemide. So I have reduced my preload by giving a diuretic. For example, if I am not able to give AC inhibitor or ARB to reduce the peripheral resistance or afterload, patient has got a severe renal failure, how to reduce afterload? If I cannot use AC inhibitor and ARB because of the contraindications, there you combine two drugs, namely hydralazine and nitrate. In patients who the ARBs cannot be given, like bilateral renal stenosis, severe renal failure, in pregnancy, you can use the combination of hydralazine and nitrates, which will give you significant reduction in the afterload. In patients who cannot use, we cannot use these AC inhibitors and ARB. So that's how you can see this diagram. In acute heart failure, we have addressed the backward failure with the diuretics, forward failure with the positive inotropic agent or the combination. In chronic heart failure, we block the renin angiotensin system, we block the sympathetic system, we block the aldosterone system through this. These are the three group of drugs which will decrease the mortality in heart failure. To give the symptomatic benefit, I use digoxin to improve the contraction of the heart. To relieve the congestion, I use the diuretics to reduce the preload. In those patients where I cannot use AC inhibitors or ARB to reduce afterload, I used a combination of hydralazine and nitrate to reduce the afterload. This is how you plan your treatment of heart failure. Looking at this diagram, so this will give you everything in heart failure, what is the mechanism, how you use the drugs. Then of course, that's the other group of drugs is metabolically acting drugs. So whenever the patient is in heart failure or in coronary artery disease, we prefer the myocardial cell to be in glucose metabolism rather than free fatty acid metabolism. The myocardial cell utilizes two substrates, glucose and free fatty acid. At this point in time, you are utilizing glucose for your heart. Why? Post-meal. Post-prandial state, heart utilizes glucose. In a fasting state, it utilizes free fatty acid for ATPs. But when the patient is in heart failure or coronary heart disease, we prefer the heart to be, heart cell to utilize glucose rather than free fatty acid. What this metabolically acting drugs do is to convert the free fatty acid metabolism to a glucose metabolism. All your three drugs, trimetazidine, L-carnitine, and also coenzyme Q, ultimately convert your free fatty acid metabolism to a glucose metabolism, which is beneficial in heart failure. Of course, these are the metabolic acting drugs. They do not decrease blood pressure. They do not decrease heart rate. They will not interfere with the myocardial contraction. They will not depress myocardial contraction. So they do not have a significant side effect at all. So they will not have any side effect. But we are not sure whether they have effects or not. So the recent drugs are the ivabradine. The ivabradine is a drug which will be acting on the sinus node, acting on the diastolic slope of the sinus node action potential, will reduce the heart rate. So now we know reducing the heart rate is very beneficial to variety of conditions like coronary heart disease, heart failure and so on. So when you use digoxin, when you use beta blocker, still the heart rate is high. You cannot increase digoxin, you cannot increase beta blocker, or some conditions you cannot use beta blocker because the patient got severe asthma or very severe peripheral artery disease. At the same time, the heart rate is high. In those conditions, if you use ivabradine, which is a heart rate reducing drug, there is a significant reduction in the mortality of heart failure. So this is one of the important trials, recent trials called SHIFT trial, which has shown significantly reduces the major risk associated with heart failure. So you can see, can be used if the heart rate is more than 70 per minute. This drug does not work if a heart rate is less than 70. There is no need. Only if the heart rate is more than 70 or tachycardia, you have to use this drug to bring down the heart rate if you are not able to do that with a beta blocker. So the other important drug in heart failure which is emerging is omega-3 fatty acids. There are some trials which have shown that there is some amount of decrease in mortality in heart failure. So these are the not routine drugs we use. Sometimes if none of the other drugs are available, none of the other drugs are acceptable, we may resort to these type of drugs. There are two difficult situations I will tell you. One is in spite of therapy and because of therapy. In spite of therapy, the patient may have a diuretic resistance. The diuretic resistance is defined as persistent congestion in spite of using 240 mg of furosemide per 24 hours. You use 240 mg, still the patient has got pulmonary venous congestion, he's got systemic venous congestion, is diuretic resistance. Always check whether the patient is taking drugs, salt and fluid restriction. Rule out severe hyponatremia and volume depletion. When the patient has severe hyponatremia and volume depletion, diuretics may not work. If these two things are ruled out, then you can start them on aldosterone inhibitor. You can switch over to prasimide from furosemide. Always give furosemide twice a day. Very important advice. Don't give furosemide as a single dose because it's a short acting. It will act and produce some hyponatremia and go. This hyponatremia will stimulate renin-angiotensin system. Next 12 hours, there will be exaggerated increase in your renin-angiotensin system. So you have to cover 24 hours by using twice a day furosemide. We can also consider short-term intravenous infusion of diuretics. Refractory heart failure, you have to optimize the medications, check the compliance, check the diet and water, and also treat anemia, arrhythmia, and infarct endocarditis. Address the comorbidity site, sleep apnea. Important is sleep apnea. Many of your refractory heart failure, refractory hypertension, refractory angina may be due to sleep apnea. Always see whether the other drugs the patient is taking. When the patient is not responding to medical line of management, as I told you about the cardiac resynchronization therapy, where by putting two wires, one inside the right ventricle, another over the left ventricle, we make the heart to contract synchronously. This is the treatment of choice in refractory heart failure. So in addition to cardiac resynchronization therapy, if the patient has got a malignant ventricular arrhythmia, if you give the automatic implantable cardioverter defibrillator, you will significantly reduce the sudden death. So these are the pharmacological means by which you decrease the mortality. These are the pacemaker or electrical means by which you decrease the mortality by giving a CRT and also CRT and the AECD therapy. See, these are the other modes of therapy in heart failure. External enhanced counterpulsation, EECP, remodeling surgeries, left ventricular assist devices, and ultimately heart transplant is ultimate answer to heart failure. The other problem during the treatment will be a cardiorenal syndrome. Cardiorenal syndrome is increase in creatinine in spite of patient is becoming better for heart failure. So heart failure symptoms are decreasing, renal functions are deteriorating is cardiorenal syndrome. It is the strongest predictor of a poor outcome. It's most often due to diuretics we use, most often due to ACE inhibitor. The irony of the treatment is treatment of heart failure producing a renal disease. So this is a cardiorenal syndrome. So the cardiorenal syndrome, we have to rule out reversible causes like urinary tract infection, hypovolemia, urinary tract obstruction, and usually reduce the dose of ACE inhibitors, ARBs, and also diuretics, and switch over to carbidolol. So this is the treatment in cardiorenal syndrome. The other major problem with the treatment of heart failure is hyponatremia. Whenever the sodium is less than 135 on admission, very bad prognosis. It is due to dilutional hyponatremia. So whenever there is a hyponatremia during the treatment of heart failure, reduce water intake and try to give continue to use the furosemide in a low dose, because furosemide will excrete more water than solute. Now we have a drug called tolvaptan, which is supposed to be used for euvolemic or dilutional hyponatremia. So these are the two problems for during the treatment, because of treatment. Cardiorenal syndrome and hyponatremia come because of your treatment. Whereas diuretic resistance and refractory heart failure is in spite of your treatment. So these are the two difficult problems. Anemia and heart failure, always keep hemoglobin around 12.5. It's ideal hemoglobin in your heart failure patients. So look for renal disease. Primarily look for renal disease. Many times the renal disease is causing the anemia. So address the iron deficiency, nutritional factors, and also you can give IV iron now. IV iron is available now, or the erythropoietin and so on. Oral anticoagulation should be given whenever the patient has got atrial fibrillation or patients have intracavitary thrombus, either in the LV or in the LA. There are some recommendations when the LA is more than 5.5 itself. Even without thrombus, you can give oral anticoagulation therapy. Keep INR around 2 so that the patient will not have bleeding, patient will not have thrombus. So sum up, as you can see that you have the 4 stages of heart failure. In stage A, you use drugs which will address hypertension, diabetes, metabolic syndrome, you will prevent heart failure. In stage B, always use ACE inhibitors and beta blockers in asymptomatic LV dysfunction so that you prevent stage C. In the symptomatic heart failure, you must always add digoxin, diuretics and aldosterone inhibitors for the symptom relief as well as decrease in mortality with the stage D heart failure. In stage D, you have treatment like cardiac resonance compensation therapy, AICD and electronic assist devices, and ultimately heart transplant. So these are the treatments available depending upon the stage. So this is my summary. The mortality reducing drugs are ACE inhibitors, beta blockers. These are disease modifying drugs. Increased survival plus or minus symptoms. 4 group of drugs: ACE inhibitor, beta blocker, aldosterone inhibitors, receptor blockers like valsartan, nitrate and hydralazine. Must in all patients, almost can be used in all stages, except beta blocker cannot be used in stage 4. And of course, here because you are modifying the disease, doctor is happy. Then the symptom relieving drugs like digoxin and diuretics decrease symptoms. They do not have impact on survival. So most often symptomatic patients from New York Heart Association stage 2 to 4, C and D stages of patients, here the patient feels good. The metabolically acting drugs, we do not know what they do. They are trimetazidine, carnitine, coenzyme Q. Sometimes in selected patients, here the industry feels good because they are costly drugs. The newer drugs like evabradin, omega-3 fatty acids, now we need to know what they do and we need to know who will be feeling good in future. So this is the, in nutshell, your treatment of chronic heart failure. So the chronic heart failure is nothing but a weak horse trying to pull a wagon full of load against the hill. So this is your heart failure. So you try to reduce the load on the wagon, that is a preload, by giving a diuretic. You reduce the load on the wagon. You try to make the slope little more flat so that the horse works with the less resistance. This is your vasodilatory, ACE inhibitors, ARB, hydralazine and nitrate. The horse is failing. So at times you have to improve its performance by whipping the horse by digoxin and positive anatrophic agents. But if you continue to whip, it will die. So what you do, whip for some time and give little more efficiency by giving some rest by the beta blockers, carbidolol, metoprolol and bisoprolol. Of course, you try to improve the nutrition of the horse by giving the metabolic drugs. So if you remember this horse, you know everything about heart failure. Thank you for your patience. Any doubts? No doubts. எல்லாம் தூங்கிட்டாங்க. எஸ் ஐவி இன்ட்ராவீனஸ்.